Welcome to the Education and Empowerment Podcast. In this show, our hosts explore success and advancement through education by interviewing today's top leaders in the fields of education, business, and technology in order to provide insight into what it really takes to succeed. This show is brought to you by Forestay, a SaaS-enabled online booking marketplace for student and intern housing. Forestay provides turnkey, all-in-one, cloud-based accommodation software solutions for colleges, universities, and organizations. Learn more at offcampus.forestay.com and landlords.forestay.com. All right, let's get into the show.
You're tuned to Education and Empowerment Podcast. This is your host, Bakhtiyor Isoev, and today I'm honored to interview Dr. Andrew Flagel. Dr. Andrew Flagel is the president and CEO of the Consortium of Universities of Washington Metropolitan Area. He received undergraduate and master's degrees from consortium member institution, George Washington University, where he served as a regional director of admissions before being appointed as director of admissions for the Congressional Youth Leadership Council. He later received his Ph.D. from Michigan State University's prestigious program in higher, adult, and lifelong education, while serving as a director in Flint for the University of Michigan, focusing his research on access and inclusion. As Dean of Enrollment for over a decade at another consortium member institution, George Mason University, Dr. Flagel created groundbreaking new programs for members of the military, veterans, international, and transfer students. He founded and led Washington Youth Summit on Environment and Washington Journalism and Media Conference, and spearheaded the Pathways partnership with Northern Virginia Community College and Fairfax County Public Schools. He left Mason to become Senior Vice President at Brandeis University, serving both as Chief Student Affairs and Chief Enrollment Officer. Prior to joining the consortium, he served as Vice President for Advancement at the American Association of Colleges and Universities, where he successfully developed a broad range of innovative partnerships with nonprofit organizations, foundations, and private companies to support quality and equity throughout higher education. You'll be surprised to know that Dr. Flagel is a visiting senior scholar at the George Washington University and serves on the board of trustees at the connecteddmv.org and the DC College Access Program, on the board of directors for the Greater Washington Board of Trade, and the state executive for the District of Columbia for National Association of Independent Colleges and Universities. He was also a member of the President's Trust for the American Association of Colleges and Universities, the Washington Higher Education Secretariat, and the Millennium Campus Network Global Education Council, and the Council for Adult and Experiential Learning, the Washington Journalism and Media Conference Advisory, and the Santa V Summer Music Festival Board of Advisors. He previously served as Senior Scholar for the National Research Center for College and University Admissions, and on the Board of Trustees for the Tremont School. Wow, you'll love this episode, because in this episode, Dr. Andrew Flagel and I will be discussing the role of university partnerships and collaboration in increasing student empowerment and engagement. For the education leaders, CEOs, presidents, and anyone interested in discovering growth opportunities within higher education, this episode will be a golden opportunity to get inspired and to learn. I look forward to exploring the lessons that can be learned from navigating through tough conditions and unprecedented times, and how the biggest obstacles can be handled if you have the right university partnership program. I know, you want to dive in. So am I. Let's get started. Hello, and welcome to the Education and Empowerment Podcast. This is Bakhtiyor Isoev. I'm your host for the show, and today I am very much honored to welcome Dr. Andrew Flagel. Dr. Andrew Flagel will be talking about the role of university partnerships and collaboration in increasing student empowerment and engagement. Without further ado, Dr. Flagel, welcome to our show.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
This is great. We are in a very important moment right now. Higher education is coming back to some way of normalcy, and there's a lot of discussion what the future is like. But there's also a lot of discussion about how university leaders were able to actually go through these tough times. And the conversation is very important because at the end of the day, we are trying to help young people to succeed, whether they are in classroom or outside of the classroom. So the role of university partnerships is very big, and I'm really looking forward to learning more about how that works and what the details are. Before we go into the topic itself, I was curious if you bring a little bit more into the whole background. What made you successful? How did you get into higher education in the first place?
I guess what has made me most successful has been absolutely phenomenal opportunities and mentors, and I'm deeply grateful to the vast amount of privilege that I came into that made a lot of this possible. I was raised by a terrific set of parents in Dayton, Ohio. My mom was an English teacher who became a community activist, was the first woman on city council in our town, and went on to found one of the largest economic authorities in the country, and focused particularly on social justice and equitable economic development. So I was raised with the idea of being engaged in social justice and activism, came to Washington, D.C. for college, which is no doubt the world's greatest college town. With that in mind, was on my way to law school and decided that I would take a detour. I had worked at almost every office on campus, partially out of necessity. My family's business, my dad's business, fell on hard times while I was in school. I became somewhat food insecure. We weren't using that terminology at the time, and ended up working multiple jobs, and was so that the folks on campus found a number of roles for me, both on and off campus, that allowed me to remain in school and fund my education. And by the time I graduated, having worked in almost every office, I decided that I would take the summer to work in admissions, and just fell in love with the work with students at that moment when they were deciding what they were going to do. Right. So I begged the director of admissions, managed to get my first position there. Much to my parents' dismay, I turned down law school, started a master's in education, and started the focus of my research on access and equity. My research on how to transform educational enrollment led me to Capitol Hill. I was asked to work on those issues at the Congressional Youth Leadership Council. And that work brought me to Flint, Michigan. The University of Michigan recruited me to work on community relations and engagement and enrollment there. So I had the opportunity while there to work on my Ph.D. at Michigan State, which began my work really on collaboration among institutions. I was working on partnerships with community colleges, did my Ph.D. work on access for students through transfer, and got to do a national study thanks to a partnership with a nonprofit, which brought me back to Washington as Dean at George Mason University, where again, I began working on a lot of collaborative programs. Mason, an incredibly innovative institution here in the Washington area.
Right.
Spent a couple of years, I was up as a senior vice president at Brandeis University. I had the extraordinary experience to work for the American Association of Colleges and Universities, working in partnerships and collaborations nationally. Right. And that led me back here to the consortium as president just last July, really still at what we thought might be the end, but was still the early days of the pandemic, to be president and CEO of the consortium.
That's great. And congratulations. I mean, I was reading your bio, and I mean, there's definitely some secret sauce or the recipe, I believe, which is very important. And you shared some of that. I was hoping that you could talk briefly about what makes leaders successful. What are those critical ingredients that you have noticed in your own upbringing and working with many universities and colleges around the world, and obviously in your position now?
Yeah, I think working in higher education is such a distinct field. And so I'll talk about a few things that nearly every book on leadership will talk about. It's certainly a matter of being innovative and having the right timing for innovation. I think there's a huge part of my career has been understanding my commitment to service leadership, to making difference and committing to those around me. I've been so fortunate to build great teams and have terrific mentors that I work for, that encouraged my career, and I was able to encourage those around me to take leadership positions all over the country. But then I think there's an element of timing. There's a couple of wonderful books, Leadership Jazz and others, that speak to this use of the moment. And really, whether you're talking about leadership in business or leadership in education or leadership in the classroom, reading that moment. But I think particularly for higher ed, the topic that you raised today is an area that we underestimate in terms of leadership. We have built a 14th century guild system in higher education based on tenure, based on our development in the 1950s of broadening where we went with higher education. In that broadening, we created a replication of the tenure system in our silos of different pockets on our campuses. So if physics and biology and engineering didn't really talk to each other in a substantive way, you also have advising and admissions, and you have academic advising versus career advising versus enrollment advising versus financial aid advising. And it creates, I think, artificial boundaries, both within the academy and across the academy, between institutions and between private entities. So I've been fortunate. I had this opportunity to work on the Hill with a really renegade, innovative nonprofit for almost 5 years before I returned to higher ed. And that group was willing to partner with almost any organization that they thought would advance students. And so when you're working on issues of equity and you look at the groups that have done really remarkable work, those groups are often willing to think really creatively about what partnership means. And I think that's, for my career, what has really made a difference in terms of opportunities. It's the partnerships inside the organization, whether I was working as a dean of admissions on building an arts program or building a journalism program, or whether I was collaborating on campuses overseas, or whether as working with a national association, I was doing partnerships with Microsoft and thinking about creative ways we could work on new innovative virtual events. I think that idea has been underestimated in higher ed, and particularly the potential of really creative partnerships among higher ed institutions. We've just barely scratched the surface at where that potential is.
And I think, you know, what you're saying right now is really coming from a place of passion. I could really feel it. I was hoping that you could tell us about the work that you do at the consortium, because most of what you do is exactly the partnerships and collaboration. And I would like our audience to get to know your role there. And you came in at a very critical moment in an entire industry, whether that's higher education or any other. I mean, it's July of 2020. It's one of those critical moments where everyone was trying to see where are we going, what's going to happen. Tell us more about the consortium.
Yeah, I'm fortunate to inherit a remarkable organization at an extraordinary time. The consortium represents a membership of all of the regionally accredited colleges and universities across the National Capital Region. I won't try to name them all, because inevitably, if I leave one out, it will be problematic for everyone. But you've got around the Beltway, of course, the University of Maryland and George Mason University, and our massive community colleges, Northern Virginia Community College, Montgomery, Prince George's. Inside, you've got UDC, which is the nation's only urban land grant, historically Black college. You, of course, have Howard, which has been beautifully in the news of with some really landmark transformations. You have Gallaudet, the only deaf and hard of hearing serving university in the country. My alma mater, George Washington University, AU Georgetown, Marymount Trinity Catholic. And we have federal universities, the National Defense University, National Intelligence University, the Uniform University of the Health Services. So that provides you an association almost unlike any other, because we have publics, privates, community colleges, research one institutions, small colleges, and that is highly unusual. The fact that we're in a close geographic area, but cover two states, well, a state, a commonwealth, and a city, as one might say.
Right.
And that these organizations came together so long ago. So the consortium actually is one of the older organizations in higher ed. We were founded back in the 1930s and constituted fully in the 1960s as a nonprofit. Wow. And so I come in after a couple of phenomenal leaders who grew the organization. at a moment when we have some of the most dynamic and diverse leaders in higher education right here in the district, who selected me with a vision towards collaboration innovation, building on that history to take the next leap in how colleges and universities could work together. So having as our current chair, President Wayne Frederick, himself a surgeon, the president of Howard University, our incoming chair and current vice chair, Bobby Cordano, a truly remarkable president, Guy Yedet, laid a groundwork for being able to work across these presidents over the past year and with all of our many other committees. So we have standing committees of the provost, of the emergency managers, of the registrars, and then created 10 additional working groups to respond to the COVID crisis, everything from testing and surveillance to how we could do better purchasing collaboratively. And I would say the crisis was a tremendous catalyst for collaboration that has really opened new avenues of how universities might think creatively and even far outside what they'd imagined previously for how they can come together to create new access and equity pathways for students, to create new opportunities for workforce development, and to create new efficiencies and revenue potential. So it's not just about how do we do better cross-registration, although I think that's an important function of the consortium itself, but how do we think really boldly about what higher education ought to look like 10, 20 years from now?
That's a huge responsibility and an opportunity at the same time. I definitely believe that, you know, partnerships both inside and outside organizations, just like you mentioned, do open a lot of doors that otherwise you as a one institution not able to carry on or to see. I really believe that most of that was actually tested very strongly last year in 2020. And when you look back to 2020 and the whole pandemic, what sort of lessons would you say leaders like yourself and leaders of the given institutions, you know, were able to communicate with you? Like what sort of challenges were there? I mean, obviously around, you know, March 14, when everything was announced, people were still at work. And then all of a sudden, you know, everything was shut down. Can you walk us through that moment and what you observed being the challenges and the lessons that could be taken away?
Yeah, so I came in after a lot of the closures had happened, but I was working certainly in higher education in a national association. And I think what it really honed was a couple of quick lessons. One is the importance of having partnerships with private organizations, with philanthropy, looking very quickly at what are the opportunities to address the crisis at hand. But it also sharpened, you know, this was an interesting crisis for sharpening the perception that there are additional opportunities that we just haven't begun to explore and that we need agreements in place to allow for an even greater sharing of resources. When we began to shut down, there was an immediate recognition that you couldn't shut down entirely. You had to keep some students on campus.
Correct, yeah.
So think about the incredible cost and risk in the midst of a pandemic of managing students in a campus designed for X number, and now you had just a fraction of that. What we didn't do, and really anywhere in the country, is immediately move into, okay, how could we collaborate on this?
Right.
Could we move those students into common space? Could we share responsibility for serving those students? How could we think creatively about this crisis in this moment? We began to get a lot better at that as we moved forward, as we thought about testing, as we thought about vaccination, as we thought about what the next steps were. But that moment, because those collaborative agreements weren't already in place, we weren't as great. Now, some places did it better. Boston was probably the national leader in getting testing coordinated among higher education with that huge partnership with the Broad. So there are models that we can see out there for where having, for instance, in Boston, they had a purchasing collaborative that could be a facilitator for putting a lot of that together. So how do we leverage those models to say, wow, here's something that worked really well for lifting up a bunch of institutions with online partnerships. Here's an area that worked really well for purchasing collaboration. Here's an area that worked well for student and emotional health, which we're going to need to still address in really substantive ways that we haven't begun yet to confront the rising tide and need of our students on the emotional health arena. So as we look at those issues that are coming towards us, we can take lessons away from how universities responded together. We can also look at how we learn from each other throughout this. So where I think the consortium itself had great strength was regular convenings of our presidents, of our provosts, of a reopening committee, of folks around testing and contact tracing. So when we worked on testing, for instance, we had two universities that had large hospitals that were able to run their own COVID testing centers. But their folks still came to the meet, even though they had already solved for X, right? They had cost-effective, very accurate testing, but their outstanding members of their faculty who had worked on those projects came to our consortium meetings and said, here's what we learned. Here's how you can think about some of the other tests that are being compared. Maybe we could scale up what we're doing, but actually maybe this is a better concept. And that informed a decision that allowed us to radically not only expand testing, COVID testing for our universities, but we're now the backbone for expanding testing in the public charter schools here in the region and the public schools in Baltimore. So that was through not only a partnership among our universities, but that extended to a partnership with the Rockefeller Foundation. So we were able to think creatively about how we would come together by leveraging the expertise that we have on our campuses in a very selfless way at this moment of crisis. And I think that really highlights, if you step back from the idea that universities are competing with each other, and you look instead at what's the mission that we have more broadly, what are the distinctions that we bring to the table, and how can we operate collaboratively in that environment, we're able to propel ourselves and catalyze the work that we do in really powerful ways.
This is really, really empowering. You know, my own sort of motto and the mission that I have over the course as I grew myself in the field, I definitely had the same reality that there is so much of this competition. Oh, I want to do better. I have the best dorm. I have the best facilities. I have this best and this best. But when a situation like pandemic happens, then everything else just doesn't matter. Then we start thinking creatively, okay, what was the mission? Why are we here? And, why are we here? And what sort of, mission we need to fulfill? And that's where the whole idea comes that, hey, we are here to collaborate.
There wasn't just the pandemic crisis. There was an economic crisis. And there was a meeting of the moment of the recognition of the racial systemic racism crisis that has been burdening our world and this country in particular. And that's a reckoning that continues to unfold. That the pandemic, God willing, is starting to come to a close does not minimize these other crises that we still have. And I would add to that the crisis of student emotional health, the crisis of opioid addiction, the crisis of enormous disparity in equity and academic achievement. So I think we have tremendous challenges presenting before us, and that collaborative attitude is the opportunity within those challenges to meet those moments. And I'm hopeful by what I see among these college and university presidents. I'm fortunate to work for folks who are far more talented, far more brilliant than I am, and get the opportunity to serve them and provide a forum for them to take their ideas and their goodwill and their service to one another and be able to facilitate that happening in ways that are so.
You actually sparked a question and maybe a thesis at the same time. When I look back to, okay, pandemic this year, then 2008 economic crisis, then 2001 is the 9/11. And there's every 10 years, there's, some sort of crisis. If you were to find yourself in a position, and I think you're in a very good position to actually not only to learn from this talented presidents, but at the same time, advise the new generation, young higher education leaders that come whenever in the future. What sort of critical lessons, or I would say suggestions, would you give to the next generation of higher education leaders in anticipation for a future that's unknown, basically?
So I think it's critical to know yourself. And when I say know yourself, I know your institution. And when I talk about that, what are we trying to do at our college or university? And what are the values that we bring to the table? What is the value equation that we bring for our faculty, for our students, for our alumni? And too often we get caught up in believing that our bureaucratic systems are equivalent to our quality. And by that, I mean our ratings, our rankings, our assessment of our research, the tenure system, the rules that we have that turn out when we study them in depth, often are operating not only not in support of, but in opposition to our goals. Some examples of academic policies that we've always considered kind of sacred cows to higher education.
Right.
Residency. So there's a whole category of rules called residency requirements. Mm-hmm. And they take a lot of different forms. You have to do X credits in residency at an institution to be of that institution, finish certain credits at the end. Well, what does that mean after we all went online? What does that mean? And if we get rid of that, what else is possible? If you don't worry about residency requirement, can you bring someone back to finish a degree in a creative way? Can you partner with other institutions on a degree? Is it about how many hours you spent in a seat, or is it about the learning that you obtained? Is it about the goals that you got? And I think we need to ask those questions really boldly, because it turns out a lot of those rules that we have turned out to be some of the big inhibitors to not only creative thinking, but to student achievement. There's some wonderful studies, the University Innovation Alliance, a terrific consortium that I really admire and looked at as I was thinking about this position, worked closely with a number of universities around student success. And some of the best research in their group came out of a school in Atlanta, Georgia State. Georgia State serves an incredibly diverse population, and the increase in success of their students is remarkable. Now, they did a lot of different things to make that happen. But among my favorite things they did was clearing out rules that kept students from graduating. Now, think about how simple that sounds. But most universities have rules that keep you from graduating. What do? Well, it turns out that very short dollars at the end, if a student built up fines for this or late fees for that, their high need often is the inhibitor. They can't get past that financial block at some point, and they leave. And so they started a program of automating microgrants. In the last year or 2 years of a student's academic program, they went in, no asking, not the student had to apply for it. They didn't have to work the bureaucracy.
Wow.
They didn't say, I have this much need. They just took everyone who had a certain level of debt on the book, and they paid it. And guess what? Their graduation rate leapt forward. And the dollars were tiny, and the net revenue went up.
Amazing.
So our own rules work against us far too often. And so when we start to think creatively, if you start to think about what it looks like to be a student at one institution doing a minor at another institution, when you start to think about what it looks like to be finishing your baccalaureate degree and starting your master's at another at the same time,
exactly,
you start to get a picture of what it looks like to think boldly. And then add to that stackable credentials with private industry.
Correct.
Certificates with business. And you start to weave together an idea that isn't the end of the educational values that we treasure. It doesn't stop the kind of liberal education that we believe in terms of the central learning outcomes. It magnifies it. It expands on it.
Right.
And so I think that's, we're often in the art of the either or in higher education. You're either in a career track or you're in academics for academics' sake. Whereas there is this concept of learning, and AACNU, my former organization, does a great job of studying this, of looking at what are really the outcomes that education is designed to give at its core. And it turns out those creative thinking, critical thinking, communication, collaboration, I just did a lot of alliteration, I apologize, it wasn't intentional. But all those C's I just named, creative, collaborative, critical, are exactly what employers most want. And so it turns out if we do the thing we're meant to do really, really well, we're actually meeting the moment for the future work, which also raises the idea that we need to do a far better job communicating about higher education, which is another collaborative opportunity. Each university itself saying, I'm really, really good.
Right.
As a particularly false note for a whole variety of reasons, but the opportunity to collaboratively talk about, for instance, Washington, D.C., that I mentioned, which is the nation's greatest college town, is a terrific opportunity to talk about the work that we do in the community, the way we got vaccines and arms on our campuses, the way we provided testing to the secondary schools, the service learning that our students do and the research that our faculty contribute, and the economic impact that our institutions have. The Washington, D.C. region, the universities are the largest collective employer. We're the largest collective landowner. This is just a phenomenal area of education, aspiration, and outcome. And one of the most powerful ways to talk about that is to talk about it in the aggregate rather than individually. And that doesn't make it any less exciting when Marymount University becomes the region's leading Hispanic serving institution, or when Howard University brings in, oh my gosh, Felicia Rashad to be the new of the School of the Fine Arts. It doesn't minimize individual achievement to talk about collective action.
This is really mind-blowing. As I'm listening to you, I think I'm getting my PhD in higher education. This is a very strong narrative to further explore. On that note, you mentioned something very extremely important here, which is, you know, the creativity and the collaboration and the purpose of education. And I really liked the example that you brought from Georgia State. You mentioned is using the micro grants to really automate and really redesign ways that they actually help their students graduate. And I'm sure it's very true, because think about it from a perspective that the sooner the students graduate, the sooner they get in new leads, the sooner other people will find out how successful X, Y, and Z was, and the sooner they get more people. So I bet their revenue went up. And I think the whole notion of that one example is very enlightening, because that really makes us think about what are those things that we need to consider as higher education professionals in the light of recovery of higher education and the sort of the closure of the pandemic. And this is where I guess the major question begins. Why is partnerships important? What are those critical elements that you would highlight important for leaders to consider? If I'm a leader of a university, what would you say? Where should I begin?
I want to kind of parse your question into two areas. I think universities have only just scratched the surface of who we can and should serve.
Yeah.
We have models, if you look at where community colleges have grown over the past 30 years,
right,
to say all of higher education can transform who we serve. And so there's a phenomenal movement with the Gerontological Society of America to think about universities as age inclusive. If you think about the 50 plus, the 65 plus, D.C., there was a massive expansion of population in the 65 plus in the past 10 years. General population remained flat or even shrank to some extent. So you have a demographic cliff of traditional aged college goers, while you have an explosion of senior citizens. And when that's happening, what does that mean for our service model? Are there elements of serving an age-inclusive society? We know we have failed an enormous number of students over the past three decades. There are students who went to college and never completed and are out there in our communities. How do we reach out to the look at models like Reengage and Re-Up that bring thousands of students back to college to complete, to upskill, to re-engage? So I think we not to mention the students who are already in our institutions that are underserved in our schools that need to be raised up, brought into our institutions, and retained and graduated. If you think about those challenges alone, just in terms of a trajectory of enrollment, then you look on the other hand at the question you asked about the power of partnership.
Correct.
And I talked about, on one hand, you have private organizations, companies that are on the leading edge. They can afford to do really high risk, interesting innovation and attempts in a way that universities won't. Those are great opportunities for partnership. Let the both private and innovative nonprofits take some of the edge off these experiments, work with them to try new things. I think there's the collaborations with philanthropy and with area business, whether it's about equity or workforce development or a whole variety of other programs and pursuits. And then within one another, are there opportunities as you look at all those pieces efficient at what we do and even do an enhanced revenue to take some of the burden off of students to be able to control our costs? So universities are not efficient operations by and large, but I'll tell you, just two examples that are a little bit easier for folks to get their mind around. We're watching one play out nationally right now, cybersecurity. If we've been coming through a crisis, we just realized there's another crisis sitting out there in this whole world of cybersecurity. And universities have an interesting opportunity in the way their systems stitch together to think about how we might come together. And there's actually some state consortia already working on this, on collaborative cybersecurity, on shared resources in cybersecurity, which makes so much sense. How could small institutions possibly have the scope to do the kinds of cybersecurity that is needed in today's society? So how can we create a dome, an umbrella of protection for institutions collaboratively? Another I've mentioned several times is the student health and particularly student emotional health. Are there ways that we can be collaborative on those fronts, on student insurance and the costs in that arena? And so those are wildly disparate areas within a university, right? The IT sector versus the student health sector.
Correct.
But the idea that you can bring universities together to think creatively and think with the private sector who has expertise in these areas and say, how do we all bring that together in a way that might solve for X in a way that goes well beyond what we'd be able to do individually?
Right.
That demonstrates, it's just kind of an easy demonstration that of the old adage that sometimes 1 + 1 = 2, but if right. you can actually make 1 + 1 = more than 2, you've got that extra benefit of partnership and collaboration.
That's certainly very amazing. I'm for STEM also doing partnerships. I oversee, a portfolio of over 500 different partners from nonprofit sector, for-profit, universities and colleges. And I get amazing opportunities to interact with people in sectors. And the ideas are mind-blowing. Sometimes you would think, this is the only way to solve this. But when you actually have a partner who's actually skilled or more professional or more expert in certain field, you get that benefit, as you said, the extra set of mind or the extra set of eyes to help solve that problem, not in 10 days, but in 1 hour.
And I think so often in higher education, we have a bias against making money.
Yeah.
Right. If someone's gotten into something and they're able to do it so well that they've made a lot of money, and somehow that's less than or other than. And the reality is some folks have made a lot of money, and that doesn't mean that we have to be in it for that purpose.
Correct.
But that doesn't preclude us from partnering with them to gain their expertise. And we've always been willing to go to the, it's interesting because we love the people that make money when we're asking them directly for money.
Right.
That we love them as donors.
Right.
But to go to them and say, we love what you've been able to do and all that you've been able to achieve. Now we'd like to leverage that expertise and still let you make money.
Exactly.
That's a different way of thinking for universities who often say, well, why couldn't we just do that? Well, because universities, there's just not the bandwidth quite often to do those things. When you're triaging every day and having been in these roles on a campus, having done student affairs, having done enrollment, you wake up every day to the next crisis. Not just this pandemic, student that's been hurt or the snow day or the next news article that's going to keep you from bringing in enough students in that year's class. And so as you're running as fast on the hamster wheel as you possibly can, it's really hard to get to anything beyond creative in your own shop.
Correct.
And so thinking really boldly often is so catalyzed by bringing in these outside groups that have the bandwidth to do things in a new and different and creative way. And it also puts some of the onus of risk there. So it allows that organization that both may make the dollars, but could also lose the dollars to hold some of the risk. And I think that's another benefit of these creative partnerships. And again, not only just one-offs of partnership, but the idea that collectives of colleges and universities can mitigate that risk and share that opportunity to an even greater extent.
You're right. And I think in this case, what's important is to have the first step, is to realize that there is a problem that needs to be addressed, and then finding the right people and the right partners to creatively solve that. Can you bring any examples from the member institutions that you are proud of, any programs or initiatives that you have seen or you have noticed that you believe that are worthy of mentioning and others should use the same models, or maybe any structures or frameworks that you notice that are scalable for other institutions?
Sure. Well, Northern Virginia Community College and George Mason University have a phenomenal partnership that was the Pathways program that evolved into Advance in collaboration with Amazon, that is allowing industry credentials and pathways of students, that is firing up a future workforce, reaching out to very diverse students, retaining students and graduating students both with associate and baccalaureate degrees at very high rates. There's a model that evolved that we're looking at across the country. I'll tip my hat on something we're not doing yet, but considering, because at the University of Maryland, they've incubated this phenomenal program for English language learners, for folks who learn English as a second language, that can be delivered online at a very low cost point and tailored to industry and settings, called Voxy NGEN, V-O-X-Y-E-N-G-E-N. And I think this company is just remarkable. And we're thinking about ways they're deploying it right now across the University of Maryland College Park. And we're thinking of ways we might deploy it in all kinds of creative ways across the consortium, not just to benefit our students, our graduate students and others who are needing to round up their English skills, but for our employees across the campus, for folks who come in research labs, for our facilities staff, for our dining staff, as a service to our communities? And could we make this available in partnership to other businesses in the region, to schools in the region? So it is when you find a really dynamic innovation, public-private partnership on a campus, then can you take that and bring that to a broader collection of institutions? And that's one that we're very excited about.
That's great. That's a very good example. And as we wrap up our episode, I was hoping that you could share an area of opportunity right now that you see working in this difficult situations and tough conditions. Obviously, I'm very impressed by how unique the consortium is. So I'm sure you see a lot of opportunities that other people don't see. So I was hoping that you could shed some light into what you see as being the biggest area of opportunity right now that could be the catalyst, as you said, to growth and sustainability and to finding the purpose of education, or kind of sticking back to what we originally thought about, which could really provoke more collaboration and partnerships.
I talked about it a little bit, but when you think about the needs of the future workforce in our region, what you want to do is stitch together a regional approach to growing equitable economic development that feeds social mobility, that creates positions that increase wealth, particularly among marginalized populations, and align that with development of academic programming and partnership. That doesn't mean, by the way, because I think we have models for how not to do this, 60s, 70s, and 80s, it doesn't mean pipelining students into jobs right now that may go away in 10 years. Not exclusively, because one of the risks we have is if we let this be fed entirely by industry, what we end up with is exactly that, right? Industry knows we need to fill these jobs in the next 10 years. We know due to AI, a lot of those jobs will go away, but that's not our worry. Our worry is getting the bodies into the job. So please to take these courses and do these things and help our jobs. What higher ed's responsibility is to build the scaffolding around that, to say whether we're going to be serving 65 plus, whether we're bringing back individuals in their 20s, 30s, and 40s, whether we're serving more diverse traditional age students. In all of those populations, we have to develop an approach to lifelong learning that says you can do this credential now, but keep going, keep connecting, even if it's just a course, a semester. Or, by the way, semesters, which may go away, right? It could be in any time frames.
Correct.
But the idea that you continue that learning in all kinds of creative ways, and that learning may happen across an ecosystem. It could be happening online through University of Maryland Global Campus, or it could be happening on campus at University of District of Columbia. And then you may go down the street and be taking a course through Gallaudet or through Howard. And so the idea that it all has to happen within one space, or that it all has to happen within one track, is outdated thinking. And if instead we think about this boldly as something that students are going to need on an ongoing basis, and we keep in mind those essential learning outcomes. What are we trying to create? Adaptable learners, creative thinkers, critical thinkers. And by the way, my former boss, the president of AECMU, has a beautiful piece that she wrote about the importance of these outcomes, not only to our workforce, which I think is absolutely essential, but to democracy.
Right.
If we look at the challenges we've had and the crisis that we've had over the past year, it has not only been about this pandemic, but about people doubting what is true and not knowing how to find that out, where to be skeptical, how to read through social media noise.
Right.
The truth. And boy, that at its very core is the mission of higher education. When we can provide not only social mobility, but the critical thinking tools that allow our democracy to flourish, now we're really meeting this moment. And so that to me, when you talk about the opportunity of collaboration, is getting away from, I am trying to get this many students in this many classes in this order, and instead say, I'm trying to serve this society in these ways. How can we do that most successfully?
Wow.
And it turns out that when you think in the second way, when you think more boldly, it works better. You get more students, you get the enrollment, you enhance the revenue. So we can do, I really believe, we can do well by doing good. We can contribute so powerfully to our communities by giving students exactly the tools they need and creating a virtuous cycle of socioeconomic mobility that feeds and flourishes economic success. And we've seen it happen in small circles in many areas. I think Washington, D.C. is going to become the model for the rest of the world in how we do this comprehensively.
That's amazing. And that what really inspires me as well, and I'm sure our audience will be inspired and empowered as well. I really like the example that you brought. It definitely reminds me from the business world, is not being in the business, but on the business, and looking at this not as a challenge, but also as an opportunity to become better, to serve better, to really achieve whatever the mission is in a way that is most good for everybody, not just for yourself or that organization that you're serving. I've personally been really, really impressed and empowered. I'm motivated. I think this is a very, very good episode. And I think as we wrap up, I was hoping that you could share a piece of either advice or a quote or something that you get inspired by every day.
You know, one of my favorite quotes, I love the children's books from E.B. White. Mm. One of my favorite quotes, he said, I get up every morning determined to both change the world and have one hell of a good time. Sometimes this makes planning the day very difficult.
I agree.
And I hope, you know, one of the great things in my life, I loved college and I made a decision. So I get to spend the rest of my life in college and working with individuals who want to change the world, who want to produce and disseminate knowledge. And whether you're talking to students who are at the start of their academic careers or who have been doing this for 30 years, they are energizing and inspiring. So that I encourage folks to find the thing that they can do that they will get up every day and be excited about. It doesn't mean that every aspect of your work has to be something that you love, but the output of the work and the general work should be something that excites you. And I will say I consider it such a tremendous privilege to get to work with my team, to get to work with these universities, to get to work on behalf of these students and to work for this community, which I think is Washington, D.C. is a city unlike any other. To be able to go for runs around the monuments and wander through the Smithsonian Hall, it is an inspiring experience over and over again. And so come here, visit, walk our campuses, get a sense that there is no better place in the world.
I can agree more. People want to contact you. What's the best way to find you?
Sure. Easy. We're at consortium.org. We are the consortium, so easy to find us. But also I'm on Twitter at Prez Flagel and on most of the social media outlets, LinkedIn, etc. So feel free to reach out anytime.
That's amazing. Thank you so much. And thank you for the privilege to learn from you. It's definitely been an amazing learning opportunity, and I look forward to connecting with you in the future. On behalf of Education and Empowerment Podcast and Forestay, I appreciate your time and the advice and the insights that you provided. for our subscribers who are listening, please make sure you subscribe to podcast.forestay.com. Check us out on Spotify or iTunes or any other social media. Until next show, thank you so much. Dr. Flagel, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
We hope you've enjoyed this episode of the Education and Empowerment Podcast. This show is brought to you by Forestay, a SaaS-enabled online booking marketplace for student and intern housing. Forestay provides turnkey, all-in-one, cloud-based accommodation software solutions for colleges, universities, and organizations. Learn more at offcampus.forestay.com and landlords.forestay.com.